upholstery friends, and welcome to this week's episode of Kim's Upholstery Live, brought to you by Kim's Upholstery, Canvas, etc., and our friends over at SailRite. Each week we bring you a project that we're working on in our studio, and if you remember, we started this settee project last week right here with you, and we padded our seat area, got our fabric all in position, and this week we're ready to go ahead and attach that fabric to the frame and then get the support system on our inside back so we can move on to that as well. As you come in, I encourage you to say hello, let us know that you're here, and let us know where you're viewing from. It's always fun to see all the different areas that people come from around the world to watch these Facebook Live events. And we also ask you, if you don't mind, to go ahead and hit that share button with your friends so that you can share this feed out on your social media as well. So whether you're on YouTube or on Facebook, you can share in both of those places. As you come in again, don't forget to ask questions if you've got any of your upholstery and soft home furnishing questions about a project maybe that you're working on in your home or in your shop, or something that's in regards to what I'm doing here, go ahead and post those questions. We do try to answer all the questions during the live, but sometimes the activity with the conversations starts going a little bit too fast and I can't keep up with the questions. But don't worry, I will come back to you after the show and make sure we respond to those. So last week we positioned our fabric, and this is that Katia Ohlendorf fabric, which is the Scandi is the print. The color is they're blue. They have several different colors that this comes in, so this isn't your only color option for this pattern. Now, I had already cut it before the show last week. We got it into position and then we just ran out of time. So this week we're gonna go ahead and start stapling it. So just for a little review, for those of you that maybe missed last week, we padded our seat with cotton and then a final layer of Dacron. And there is a coil spring system underneath the seat with an 8-way tie as well. We had done that previous to the live last week, and that's covered with burlap. And we attached our edge roll last week too. So we are ready to go ahead and start attaching fabric this week. Now the way this print is, and you really have to pay attention when you're using a print on a piece of furniture and make sure you position everything the way you want. But it looks like a bunch of questions or comments are coming in, so I'm gonna go ahead and take a break for a second and say hello to everybody. So hello, Michelle. She says, I might have to catch up later, but we'll watch as long as I can. Hi, Kim and Bill from the UK. Well, you can always watch the replay, and don't forget you can still ask questions during replay too, Michelle. Hello, Carmelina and Cindy from Michigan, and Melissa and Bonnie and Krista. So hello, everybody, and let's see. Carmelina says, blue paint seems to have darkened a bit as it cured. Love this color. It might just be the lighting too. It's hard. I don't know if it really darkened or not, but the lighting definitely changes it. Hello, Sherry, thanks for hopping in. And it's funny because sometimes we'll turn the lights on, it looks royal blue, and it's like, that's not at all what we're going for, but it really isn't. It is definitely a deep navy. So as I was talking about the pattern of the fabrics, when you're working with a pattern, it's always important to pay attention to how you place the pattern on the piece of furniture, make sure things are laying and looking the way you want. This is such a small all-over print that I messed around with it, and there really isn't one way that looked better than the other. And the way the pattern is printed out, you end up with two of most things within the area that we have on the seat. There was no way to get a full three of stuff. So I just kind of positioned it, and I like the way it looks. And there are some of the prints that just kind of jumped out to me, so I made sure that those are on the seat area as well. And the repeat is probably, see if I can estimate here, where's my bird? It's probably about 18 inches horizontal and maybe about 25, 27 inches vertical on this print without getting measure tape out. We have some people over on YouTube. Hello, Mary and Hazel from the UK. Mary's from Texas. And Alma is here from Saudi Arabia, and Maria from North Carolina. Hello, all of you, and thanks for hopping in. And there was a comment there, Bill. Sorry, I missed it. We'll get back to it. Here you are coming here in July. Can't wait. Yes, I will be in North Carolina in July. Definitely. Okay, so let's get going with the staples. And I've got this straddling our pedestal here, so I can still turn it, but my pedestal wasn't quite wide enough to go under the legs. And actually where we're attaching it is up here, so it's actually in a really good position for me. So let me grab my little rolling stool here, because it'll be easier to sit down for the height this is at. So I'm going to start by getting a few staples across the front, and then I'll go to the back and pull the fabric too. So turn a little bit so you don't have to stare at my backside. Just double check my positioning on my print. Looking at the grain of the fabric, I'm also looking at the print, the way it hits on the piece, trying to find, oh, there it is. Trying to find the second one of that flower. Sorry, I have to scooch up a little. All right, that looks straight to me now. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and just put a few in here to get started. And at this point, I'm using the 3/8 inch staples. I've taken out the 9/16, which is what we use when we're working with support systems. So that's just enough to hold it so that when I pull towards the back, I don't pull everything with me. But obviously we need a lot more staples in there. So because of the ease of a pedestal, I can just go ahead and turn this around. And then here you can see, I'm gonna get this rubber mat out of the way because it's causing me problems. All right, so we need to go underneath the liner board to get this to the back side. And you always want to make sure before you get too far that you've left yourself plenty of fabric on each side, because there's nothing worse than getting a bunch of staples in and realizing one side you left yourself too short. And we will make cuts in this eventually, but I'm just trying to get this down here enough to get a few staples going. Okay, so I'm going to smooth my fabric towards the back. Get it tight. Landing on my liner board. Feel where my groove is here. Okay, and I'm just watching to make sure I'm keeping it tight, and it'll smooth out left to right once we get the ends done too. Right now I'm just pulling it tight towards me and out towards the outside as I go. And this fabric is, the base cloth on this is a linen poly blend, which when you order from Canvas, etc., you've got different options for your base cloth. And I'm really liking this. It's a really thick, durable fabric. Definitely good for upholstery. It would be good for slip covers as well. But most of these prints you can get on many different base cloths. All right, so now we've got a few staples left to right. So let's spin it around, take a look at it. So I also want to look from the end, make sure I've got everything looking fairly consistent, and it looks like I do. Now the ends of this attaching are definitely going to be a bugger because we got to work around these upright posts right here, and I'm going to end up probably having to do paint repair afterwards, but I've got a piece of chipboard that we're, or panel board that we're gonna be putting in there. I'm just checking it before we go.
Where'd you put your phone?
Here. You gonna call somebody who cares? No.
Yep.
Okay, so again, I'm just looking at the level of the seat. That looks pretty darn good for the first shot. All right, so now, I grab myself a scrap piece of panel board, which I'm going to use to protect the wood. So I'm going to stick it between the fabric and the wood, because we've got about a half an inch of space between the decorative wood and the seat to staple this fabric. So we're going to have to really cram our staple gun down in there. And I want to do as much damage control as I possibly can. And the other thing is you don't really want to have to remove all those staples if you made a mistake in there too. So you want to start from the center and work out for this particular design. I think I am beyond the wood there. So I know you can't see that, but if I'm up here, then all you get to do is look at my backside. So we've got some staples from about, turn so you can see. Oh, okay. So Bill's trying to show you from above. So let me move this and see if you can see in there. Yeah, I don't think you can with the blue. But anyway, we have the staples down in here. So I've got the staples pretty much right in front of this decorative piece of wood and out towards the front about an inch. So now I'm gonna head towards the back. And again, I'm gonna leave that panel board there so that I don't damage it. Or shoot by accident. Turn this way because it's up in my way in my face. think I am beyond the wood on both sides now. And it's looking good. So I'm gonna go ahead and put a couple more staples in there. And now the staples are going this way, obviously because of how I had to hold the gun. If I went this way, I could not get the gun in there. But our double welt cord will cover over the top of those. So it looks like we got some more people coming in, Bill. Hello, June from Kentucky. And I know you had sent me a message. You're looking for information on the upholstery meetup, and that will be posted in our Kim's DIY upholstery hangout group. And I'm trying to finalize the detail with one last vendor. We've been playing phone tag, so as soon as I get that information, everything will be out there, but it is in North Carolina. So you definitely want to save the dates from July 31st to August 2nd.
Okay, I'd like to know, somebody post in the comments if they can hear us okay. I cannot get our feed to come up on the phone.
The phones, okay.
So I can't check. I don't know if it's playing on the phone.
So if you guys can go ahead and say yes or give us a bunch of thumbs up so Bill knows you can hear us, because right now he cannot hear us. Just want to make sure the sound is working. Melissa says, so glad to be back and watching this. Well, good, Melissa. You did a great job yesterday for your first virtual chapter meeting as president. Hello, Joan. Thanks for hopping in. And Susan. And Sherry said, or Sherry's here from Maryland. Hello, Sherry. And Mary is from Stafford, Virginia. And hello, Debbie. We have, what do we have, one or two spots left in your workshop, Debbie, in Rochester. I forget now. So is anybody saying whether they can hear? Thumbs up, smiley faces,
yeah,
something?
Yeah, hear us just fine.
Okay, you can hear just fine. Okay, good.
Yeah,
all right.
It doesn't seem to be coming up on mobile.
Huh. All right. It could just be my phone, too. Who knows?
No, my phone's not doing it either. It's just old.
Okay, so as I was saying, the staples are going this way as I put them in just because it's the only position that I can get my gun in, and our double welt cord will cover all that. So now I go ahead and move this. I'm going to make a couple more staples here towards the back side. Now we'll go ahead and get the other end attached. Actually, maybe I'll get a couple more staples this way too, because I'm not quite as far to the front on here. This end, as I am to the back. All right, and now we'll do the same thing at the opposite end of our settee. Untangle myself. And put our piece of cardboard. Now, before I do this, I actually want to just double check. Make sure I got that nice and tight. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm thinking that's looking pretty good. Okay. Cardboard. Don't drop your guns, Kim. I tell you, these new Sailrite guns hold up really well with my klutzy behavior. And I know Rhonda had done a little video of the comparison between the two guns, and we had done an evaluation or a video about the Sailrite guns on YouTube as well. And I really do like these guns. This is where you want to be careful that you don't pull too tight in one spot and get a divot. And am I out of ammo? Nope. I just didn't fire, that's all. This is definitely one of those difficult areas to deal with. And I don't know about you, but I've always got one side that I can do easier, left versus right, and this is being my harder side for some reason here. I've always said an upholstery shop would do really well with a left-handed person and a right-handed person, so that the left-handed person does all the right arms of the chairs and the right-handed person does all the left arms of the chairs. Towards the front. And this is where you get your workout. All right, so far so good. You can take that out or drop it out. Let me just double check, see if there's one staple I'm not sure about. Yeah, I think I've got one staple at that end. It's a little bit too tight. You pulled the fabric too tight. Yeah, maybe not. Okay. Yeah, there's definitely one that's either too loose or too tight over there. This side looks much better. So I think I'm going to have to pop a couple staples, which is not fun, but we can do it. Although I think they're outside of the area of the decorative wood, but I've got kind of a divot going in towards the front here.
So it's not always easy.
So it's not always easy, Bill says. Yes, that's very true. We all make mistakes and have staples we have to remove. It's not just you, it's all of us. Yeah, I'm trying to decide, is it too tight or is it too loose there? I think it's too tight. And one thing with the heavier gauge staples, they're much easier to remove when you have to make adjustments than the fine wire staples. All right, so far no digs in the wood. And same thing on this side. I guess I was pulling pretty good, wasn't I? So like yesterday we were working on this chair for the tutorial that we're doing, and you know, Bill's like, well, do you want to stop now or do you want to keep going? Because we were both tired, but it's like when you've got your hands in the momentum and you're getting the pulls really good, it's better off to finish that part rather than stop and come back the next day. And your hands might not be pulling exactly the same way they were the day before. I do, if I'm doing one thing, I try to finish up that type of thing on the piece of furniture or whatever before I take a break. Okay, I think what I need to do is not pull at all right there by the looks. Just in between those two sets of staples. Actually, back behind the wood, I've got one spot that I need to address. So I'm using panel board for this, but you can use anything, any piece of scrap cardboard you have or anything that you can have just to protect your gun from scratching up against the decorative wood here. That's all I'm using that for. Okay, I might have to adjust afterwards, but we'll know once we get more of this attached. We'll see. It's really hard to tell in that tight spot. So now at the back of the chair here, let's have a random leftover tack. So let me just turn. Actually, I'll turn and come all the way around so I'm on the side that the camera's facing, because now we got to figure out this corner. I feel like a dentist rolling around in the chair. Actually, Bill's going to go to the dentist tomorrow. So now I'm just kind of seeing how this corner is going to play out. Get everything nice and smooth. It's definitely an awkward position here. Let's see where I've got to staple. So it goes over, the way this frame is designed, I've got like a channel along the side, but then it humps up to get over this board in the back. So it's just gonna be kind of a funky little intersection right there. So I wanna make sure that I cut in a way that's gonna make me be able to make that look neat. I'm just gonna go for it. So what I need to do is cut to get around. Actually, you can't really see there, can you? I've got to cut to get around this back post so that I can pull the fabric towards me, but I've got to leave enough to fold over to have a nice finished edge when I go towards the back. The back fabric does come down and get stapled down here as well. So there's a lot of fabric that comes through this area. All right, so what I'm aiming for is right in here behind that back post. I'm calling this the back post. It's one of those things you don't want to cut too deep, because once you cut too deep, you can't go back. You can cut too shallow and then go deeper, but if you cut too deep, you're done. And it looks like that part worked. All right, so now let's come over here, trim off some of this excess. So this is one of those projects that you look at this settee and go, that's really simple, and not even think about any of the things about getting around these areas and the little details about the back sections here. For beginner projects, you want really things that are pretty straightforward, so that you can really start to understand the skills involved and not get into the complicated things that are going to frustrate you right away. So when you do pick a first project, you really want to seriously look at the piece and see, like, pieces with a lot of curves going on are not a good first project generally. And if you're doing pieces with curves, then you've got to really make some considerations on the fabric content and the type of fabric you're working with and the fabric properties more than anything. Back into the inside, see what it's doing. Get into there, you go. All right, I think I'm gonna have to pop that one staple in the end here as well to get it to go in a nice smooth continuation. And see how easy those bigger staples come out? Didn't break off either. Now I'm gonna go do the other end before I adjust any more here. I think I am gonna have to take some of those original staples out and pull a little bit tighter in order to accommodate for the downhill that we have going on at this end. So let's go work on this side, and we'll come back. So we'll come back to the other end after, but we'll start on getting this end in the same location, so get to the same point right there. I'm just looking at the inside here, getting my pole going on. And again, I want to get the fabric down as close to that point where the woods meet, the different woods, the different components. This way I think it's going to be easier if I get my head in here to cut. Then I can really see where I'm headed. Tools over here. And then I gotta get in here with a razor blade afterwards and cut all that, which is not gonna be easy. That's good. bring this back around. Cut off all that excess, same as we did on the other side. Fold in the right position. Okay, this one looks like I don't have to adjust, so it's just the other side. Nice, I'm liking that. And if you are learning upholstery, which most of you here may be doing that, and some of you may be seasoned already, but I invite you to join our Kim's DIY Upholstery Hangout group, which is right here on Facebook. It's a great place to share with your peers and get to know one another and ask questions about projects you're working on and get some help from people that are going through exactly what you're going through. Let's see, I'm just kind of looking. I think it's just these two here. I think these are going to be okay right there, but it's just these last two. I think I'm going to have to just ever so slightly, I need it tighter than it was. Actually, maybe not. Maybe just that last one. You probably can't even see it on the camera, but I've got just an ever so slight little buckle in the fabric. And I know it's way behind and it's not going to show, but I'll know it's there. And now I'm out of ammo. So with the heavier gauge staples, you do end up going through a row of staples a little bit quicker than you do with the fine wire gauge. There's many more in the stack of the fine wire than there are in these. And we'll go ahead and turn it around and take care of the front. Now, if any of you are looking for slipcover classes, we are hosting me in Louisiana, Houma, Louisiana, on April 11th and 12th, and we still have 4 spots left in that slipcover workshop. And there's also a list of the other workshops we have on our website and what we have. I haven't put out what we have for spaces, but most of them only have 1 or 2 spots left. But you can go ahead and check those out, and maybe Bill will post a link if he has a half a minute here. All right, so now looking at this, when I come towards the front, I can see that I am probably going to have to tighten this area up here. I don't know if you can see that on camera, maybe. So you can see when I start to pull here, I get all these wrinkles, which tells me that I got to tighten this up. And that's why when you start doing these things, you don't want to fill this whole thing in, because if I had filled everything in thinking, it really looks good, now I'd be pulling staples. And now I've only got 1, 2, 3, 4 staples in there. So if I have to make an adjustment, it's not a huge ordeal. So let's see, we've got some more people hopping in here. Hello, Diana and Gina and Karen. And Peggy says, late again, but I made it from Virginia. That's okay, Peggy. Anytime you come in is fine with us. And Ragne says, you know, if you add a swivel plug to your gun, it is more easy to do the left-handed, right-handed stuff. For me, it's not so much the move on my gun, because mine does turn pretty freely.
Well,
it's
no,
my body.
She's talking about the ones we used to use that let the hose swivel from left to right.
Oh, those
and
things.
Rodney, we went through quite a few of those, and they all seemed to leak, and
they leaked,
just got tired of dealing with them. So.
They just had a lot of air leaks, but it's not, for me, what I'm dealing with right now, it's more my body. My body just doesn't want to bend as well in one position than the other. And hello, Donna, and Krista says, Ragne, where do you get those swivel plugs? So you can go ahead up. She already answered you, so I guess I don't even have to say that. And hello, Cheryl. So I see people from back in high school days here, Cheryl and Karen. And Sylvia says, I love Harbor Freight. I have purchased some good things there. Yeah, we love Harbor Freight. In fact, these little babies are from Harbor Freight, and I think I paid like $3-4 a piece for them, and I love them. Ragne says, I think any hardware store has the plugs. And then Bill put a link for you guys, and I guess that's it for questions. So, all right, so let's go ahead and work towards this corner and see what we've got to do for our adjustments here. And to do that, we're going to, oops, don't move the whole pedestal, Kim, just turn. So we're going to have to make that same cut in the front that we made on the back side, and then I will know what my fabric is telling me. Because what does the fabric do? It tells me what it wants if I listen. So, all right, so that's looking good. I think I'm actually going to get a temporary staple here in the front just to pull this down so that I know that I've got that nice curve going on. There, so that way it's easy to pull out being temporary. And where did I hide my scissors on myself? One thing with these things is I do hit the trigger all the time. I know, the thing's curved, but I don't have a lot of space on the edges. Okay.
I'm sure everybody else is laughing going, it's going to fall off there as soon as you
You guys can all see it coming, right? It's like yesterday, Bill and I were doing something, we were recording the video tutorial that we're doing for the little chair, and I was using the foam saw, and it was in the video, so he couldn't say anything, and the can of silicon is like vibrating its way to the edge of the table, and he was like so glad that we finished filming it before it fell off. So as I mentioned, this fabric is really rugged and easy to pull and stuff, so it's really good to work with. And I'm liking this material. So this was the poly linen. I think I would definitely get that again. And actually, it's the same. The poly linen is what I did for the poofs too. When I did the pink poof, that the pink and orange poof, that was the same base cloth. I forget what the percentages were of poly linen, but it's on their site. I want to say it was either 20/80 or 10/90, and I don't remember which was which. I think it was less linen than poly, so it was probably 10% linen. I don't think he's out there, but Chuck, if you're out there today watching, go ahead and let them know what the content is, percentage.
Yeah, put in a link. So
yeah, put in the link.
What it is when you're buying it.
And they have a huge selection of canvases, too, for slip covers, or bags, or upholstery. Okay, so now I'm liking the way that looks. We got that all finished towards the front corner. So now we get to finish the very front corner, just like we did on the back. And that temporary staple held the fabric from shifting on me when I was making my cut, so that my cut was where I wanted it to be. But now I need to remove it so we can cut out the excess fabric this way and go ahead and pull the fabric tighter. All right, so we don't need all of that folded underneath there. Just kind of get a gauge of what's going to happen here. Turn a little more so you can see. So what I'm doing is just pulling this tight with the fabric folded and watching what all this is doing. And it's misbehaving terribly, so which tells me it's going to come tighter. And actually, now that I feel it, I can feel that it's a little bit loose towards the front. Okay, so let's cut off some of this. So what projects are all of you working on? Any of you that are not in the upholstery world, what are you working on for DIY projects? They don't have to be upholstery. We love to hear what everybody's doing. I've got a couple fun projects coming up that have nothing to do with upholstery. All right, I think I need my regulator to get that apron to hide and not want to stick out from underneath the fabric. Now, if you do not have an upholstery regulator and you are in upholstery or soft home furnishings, you are going to want one of these babies, because it is like your extra hand. It's also like that little finger that you need to get into places and you just can't get your own fingers in there. And you can also use it, which it actually is made for, is adjusting the filling. So you can wiggle it through the fibers and adjust your filling underneath the project as well. Okay, so there now, I gotta get my gun. I guess I gotta let go. How many times do you get the fabric all in position, you get your gun, and then either you slip with your hand or you're out of staples? It's like running out of bobbin when you're sewing. This is locked, but I'm pushing so hard it's moving on me. All right, so let's see here. Try to find that ledge. Now I'm going to have to remove at least this staple and probably all with the center one, but maybe the center one too, we'll see. I did it again. There we go.
Bit of an air trigger on that thing.
I know, I keep hitting it and I grab it in the wrong place. I'm gonna pick it up.
Well, the grip is shorter, which is probably why.
Yeah, so when I'm used to the FASCO where I've got more space to put my hand in, so I just keep hitting that every time I grab it, but that's okay. As long as I'm not shooting anybody. So again, if you wouldn't mind going ahead and hitting that share button for us, we would love it. I get these little carpets rolled under here to keep the edge of the legs from banging up against the pedestal wood and scratching them all up. Let's see, position wise. I'm just looking at the fabric. I'm letting the fabric talk to me. So I gotta take a minute and listen. Okay, I can do that. See, it just told me what it wanted to do. That's it, call the insane asylum. Kim's gone nuts. She's talking to the fabric. Definitely still gonna take one more out here. Gently. Try not to tear your fabric. Don't you hate that when you're trying to take out a staple and you end up tearing your fabric? It's like, oh, it's the worst feeling in the world. Did I ever tell you guys the story about a sofa we did? I might have told this before on live, probably several times, I don't know. We were doing a sofa for a client, and it was quite expensive fabric, and it was at the end of the project. We were actually just closing up the outside back, and I had a pair of scissors sitting on the top of the arm of the sofa, and I bumped into it, and the scissors came down and went right down the front of the edge of the front of the deck and tore a big hole in it. So we had to take the outsides all back off, lift up all the insides, and replace the whole deck on the sofa. So I no longer sit my scissors up here anymore. I tend to learn things the hard way. Bill's over there grinning. So it looks like we have more comments on YouTube. Hello Hazel, she says, I'm doing a small curved back chair to use in my treatment room. It's the third time I've done it. My previous attempts predated YouTube, laugh out loud. Yeah, I know, we all started way back before YouTube, huh? And Rosa says, hello, hello Rosa. And I guess that's it on YouTube. All right, let's continue. Now, typically I go from the middle out, but this piece kind of dictated me doing exactly the opposite because those first staples were not taut enough. So it's one of those things where sometimes you have to break the rules and do things a little bit differently, and that's what this is dictating. But I'm also watching as I go to try to keep everything nice and consistent. little bit of a, no, maybe not actually. Thought I was gonna have to adjust that other one, and I'm not going to. I'm staying above where I need to. We are, we're staying off the decorative wood, which is nice, but I'm probably dinging it up down here with my tools. Okay, so now I'm gonna go ahead and make the cut over on this side, and then we should be able to finish that part and put the sagless on our inside back. Okay, so it's the same cut we did on the other side. Push this down. Well, it looks like I might have to make an adjustment going that way again. So I probably did put in too many staples this time. Get that in position. Cut right down. Trim back on the side. So you can see on this particular piece, all four corners were done pretty much the same way. Just cut to the back of the post and then trim off the excess before you pull down in the front. And that's not typical of most pieces of furniture when you've got front and back cuts. They're usually quite a bit different from one another. The more pieces you do, the more you start learning to be able to evaluate the furniture. That's one thing I find. A student will send me a picture of a piece they want to do at a workshop, and it looks basically, you know, pretty simple pretty simple upholstery and stuff. And then when you start breaking down the details, you know, I'll point things out to them, and it's like, it's not as simple as it looks. And that's why I do limit things for the workshops, so that you can really hone your skills and not be frustrated by something that's not a beginner project or not something you're going to be able to tackle during the time that we have together. Looking good, and I can see right here it's starting to bunch, so I am going to probably have to go back 5 or 6 staples. It's wanting to unfold on me here, so I just got to make sure it's keeping that fold. Get one staple in there, and I'll go ahead and work from here over. So I think I got to pop out these too. So what's been your worst horror story with upholstery, any of you? Is anybody sharing their projects out there, Bill?
Not too many.
No? So what's the worst thing that you've had happen when you're upholstering a piece? I think that story I told you was my worst. I think, knock on wood, we haven't had too many disasters that I can think of anyway. This needs to be folded a little deeper over there. Looks like my decron's poking down there. I I need to fold just a little deeper because I got the curve good. Put this one, which means I probably need to cut more fabric off to make that fold better. I think that's why I was having difficulty getting it folding, is because I had too much that I was trying to put under there. And it's scary cutting it back, I know, but sometimes it's a lot easier once you do. Get all that out there without poking into the fabric on the corner of the settee and making a hole. Aha, so I'm coming that time. There we go. I think that's going to work much better. I need my knee behind this leg because the pedestal wants to keep turning on me. We got it. Good deal. Cheryl says, I enjoy lunch with you on Wednesdays. You make it look so easy. Come on over, Cheryl, and play sometime. It's not that bad. Bonnie says, I was just going to say, I noticed you misfire with that gun a lot, haha. Yeah, I do. I just hit that trigger constantly. She's still working on patio cushions for clients. I know you had a lot of cushions to do, if I remember. What is the name of that tool? Which tool, Diane?
Well, the staple gun, and you're using this puller.
Okay, so the staple gun is the Sailrite Long Nose staple gun. This is an Osborne 120.5 staple puller. And these are just simple little inexpensive wire cutters
from Harbor Freight.
Oh, and the regulator. Maybe that's what you're talking about. This is a regulator. So it has a point at one end and then the flat at the other end. And you will use that all the time once you have one. And hello, Sandra. She's working on panels, Roman shades, and cushions. I missed your live last night, Sandra. I'm going to go back and watch that. I was falling asleep on the couch, so I didn't get to see it. Ragnay says, I'm working on getting all the clothes that are too big out of my house. God, it takes time. Literally a huge side project. I've been doing some purging too. It does take quite a bit of time to do that. Sylvia says, I'm done securing the frame on the sofa, going to start webbing. Oh, good. That's a good project that you're doing. And then Bonnie says, enjoyed your live last night, Sandra. Oh, good. You got to see it. Melissa says, the regulator was the tool she last referred to. Okay, so you were answering her question. And Debbie says, working on lots of drapes. I am so glad to not be doing window treatments anymore. I did not enjoy the window treatment world. Sorry, you guys. Just was not my thing. I'd much rather be doing upholstery and slipcovers. And hello, Joanne and Audrey. And I guess that's it. Thought I missed something there for a second. All right, so we are done with the seat, except for getting in here and trimming with a razor blade later, which I don't ever trim with a razor blade unless I am really fresh. If I'm tired at all, I will not do that, because that's when you end up making boo-boos, and that's not fun boo-boos to have happen. So let's go ahead and get our sagless on the inside back, which means I need to shift my tools. And Bill, I'm probably going to need you to help me lay this on its back in a second. Regulator. That's one thing too, with the pegboard behind me, I can just stick my tools out of the way, but they're right there handy, ready to go when I need them. Which way did my hose go? It goes that way. Yeah, so I think lay it on its back. That's what I'm thinking for this part. Shift those jackets. Yeah, let me pull my app further. All right, we're trying to get the carpets underneath the decorative wood. Make sure it's not hitting the wood there. And you get to see her bottom side. So see, there's the sagless. Oops, actually, you don't have it aimed that way, so you didn't get to see the bottom side. You get to see the back. So let me turn it around. Which way is better, Bill? This way or the other way? Probably the other way.
The other way.
Yeah. Okay. Hope you guys aren't getting dizzy watching my settee spin here. All right, so the sagless is going to be hitched on the front of the liner board down here.
Yeah, they can't really see that rail down there, so you'll have to use their imagination.
Round it blends in.
You could tip it up a little bit to show it.
That's a five without dropping it on the floor.
There you go.
Yeah, so right here is the liner board that we're going to be attaching the sagless to. And then it'll get hitched up both sides and across the top as well. And this is just going to be hand taut because this is not an area that anybody's going to sit their butt on, I hope. So it doesn't need that extra tightness, but this stuff is really strong. Here, just took it down because I'm going to need to fold it back on top of itself. So I want that part out of my way. Make sure I got plenty at the top, and I do. And what did I do with my gun? Here it is. See what we got for staples. Ooh, two staples left. We need more than that. Sure, you got plenty left to write. I'm putting them on about every half, three quarters of an inch. Keeping snug left to right with my hand as I go. And fold it up on top of itself, and I probably just put a ding in the wood up there. So now fold it, staple it down, and then we'll trim all this excess off later. Get a lot of questions about sagless. Sagless is a polypropylene fabric. It's mildew resistant. It's really, really durable. And you can get it in webbing form, but it's hard to find. And some companies call it different names. But you could also use jute webbing for this and do your webbing strips horizontally and vertically as well. See the difference here because I painted this little groove, but we have the channel here that we're going to be stapling into. Oops, except for you gotta hit the wood. Kind of key. First staple is hanging out of the side of it. I think I can just feel here and see, make sure I'm staying in the wood except for that one spot. Feels good. Just feeling behind to make sure the staples aren't peeking out. And it's important to keep this stuff tight. Right now it doesn't look tight because it's not all the way attached, but it will be. So let me trim some of that down. The rest of it after. I just needed to get that a little bit out of the way so I could fold this up in a sec. I'm actually using the frame as I pull. I don't know how much of that you can see, So I'm pulling down, but I'm actually bracing it against the frame, which helps me get it tighter. Too. And we'll come back and we'll fold that down on top of itself as well. But let's finish going across the top. Better tautness this way than holding it the way I was a second ago. Got it top to bottom and pretty tight left to right once we get this all stapled on the side. Let's see, now this is going to be that awkward side for me again. Almost shot myself there. And I'm out of staples. So next week when we come back, we'll be patting the inside back and getting the fabric on the inside back. Let's trim this out of my way here so we can finish up this sagless. But like I said, you could do jute webbing and burlap if you don't have sagless available to you. Genco Upholstery Supply out of North Carolina carries this product, and so does Albany Foam. Albany Foam calls it sagless. Genco calls it, oh God, what do they call it? I just totally lost that word. Tech something. If anybody knows, or actually if you call Genco and ask for the polypropylene and tell them what you're using it for, they'll know what it is. But those two are both two of the trade companies. But they do carry this. All right, so there, our sagless is all in place. All I've got to do is fold back over on top of itself and trim it down. So turn it around. There you go. So all I need to do now is go ahead and finish top stapling this, which I'll do off camera, and trim it down, and it'll be ready for all of you for next week. And I'll get the fabric piece cut for the inside back, and we'll pad that together. So we'll be padding it very similar to how we padded the back. So go ahead, as you're leaving our show today, go ahead and hit that share button if you wouldn't mind, and share that out there so people can watch the replay. And for those of you that are members of our online classes, we will be live at 3 o'clock this afternoon in your member portal for your live Q&A on Wednesdays. So bring your upholstery and soft home furnishing questions and your cup of coffee or tea or whatever you drink in the afternoon, and we will see you there at 3 o'clock. So thank you everybody, and have a wonderful day.